Maybe I've been living under a rock, but it recently came as a surprise to me to find out that Cyberpunk 2077 is actually based on a popular pen and paper RPG from 1988. It turns out Johnny Silverhand isn't just a dude they wrote for Keanu Reeves, he was written back in the 80s, which just makes perfect sense, really. Since then, Cyberpunk's had new editions and spin-offs and novels and card games released. It's very much expanded itself into a franchise. So it shouldn't be as surprising as it is that 2077 isn't the first video game set in Cyberpunk's world. Instead, an obscure Spanish mobile developer named Mayhem Studio had the first crack at adapting the license back in 2007 with Cyberpunk The Arisaka's Plot, and it was one of the most technically impressive feats in mobile gaming at the time. Aesthetically, this is absolutely a cyberpunk game, but I'd argue that Delphine Software's 1993 classic Flashback is easily this game's biggest influence. Each screen is fixed rather than scrolling, a lot of enemies are basically the same, like these flying sphere things, elevators are super similar, and movement is pseudo-grid-based in the same way Flashback was, or Prince of Persia, and Delphine's Another World, also known as Out of This World, for other examples. This means every movement is very deliberate and very exact. A crouched roll will always take you three spaces, a forward jump will always jump over one space, but if you're sprinting, you'll jump two. You can't sprint or jump up to a new platform with your weapon drawn, that sort of thing. It's very much a throwback to that specific subgenre of side-scrolling platformers. And considering the control limitations where Java phones struggle with multiple inputs or quick successive inputs and how every input is a digital button press, it just makes perfect sense for the game to control like this. You don't need to precisely time your jumps or aim your shots to pixel perfection, and in other mobile platformers from this era we've seen how annoying doing that can be, but here it's all very methodical. Each button corresponds to a specific action, and like the platformers it draws from, it gives itself enough breathing room to show off its animations, which are more than worth showing off. Backflipping up to a platform to kick a dude and then pulling out your dual pistols to take another guy down looks just as cool as it feels, or taking an elevator with your pistols drawn and ready is badass. The moments where you wrap your head around the old school controls and it all clicks together are just a joy. The way you move with your weapons out and reload by crouching down, and just how all the animations smoothly transition, which is again a Flashback thing, coupled with the great 16-bit throwback sci-fi backgrounds of Cyberpunk's Night City and the character sprites flickering when they're near lights, just gives it all a real vibe that's unlike much else on Java phones. It has genuine atmosphere. We're even treated to some short, again, Flashback or Another World-esque cutscenes to tie it all together, which is very, very uncharacteristic for this era of mobile games. This may not seem impressive without context, but to squeeze all this down to a few hundred kilobytes within J2ME's mobile limitations is a real achievement, especially with the variety of different themed levels. We even visit the jungle at one point, which, have I mentioned that this game is similar to Flashback? Call it a tribute or call it a ripoff, it's good at what it does either way. It does at times try to break away from that mold, however, by going back to its RPG roots, complete with what's basically a character sheet with character stats where I'm pretty sure half of them don't mean anything, and implants which give you buffs, and weapons with different stats like damage, capacity, and accuracy. Weapon damage is calculated with dice rolls, you pick up armor off bodies, and generally you'll want to search each corner of every level for new implants and weapons. Sometimes they're hidden behind doors that can only be unlocked with terminals. Use a terminal and you'll actually enter an old school terminal prompt where you'll have to remember how to text type with a phone numpad, and you can type help or clear screen or exit, or you can enter a code to unlock a door, activate an elevator, or just see a message. If the game hasn't told you the code in dialogue, try typing hack to play a simple if slightly annoying hacking minigame to get the code yourself. If you enter the nicknames of the developers from the game's credits into the terminal, you get funny little Easter eggs. If you go to the game's website, you can find cheat codes to enter, and at one point, a terminal prompts you to enter the name Conrad to return Conrad's memory, and if you do, your character's clothes change to the color scheme of Conrad's, the amnesiac protagonist of, you guessed it, Flashback. They very much know. Things get kind of experimental when the terminals sometimes tell you to go to the game's website and enter in a code, a website that, to no one's surprise, is no longer around. After some sleuthing and thanks to someone named Edababy on a WordPress site called Hard and Soft Gaming, who made the only walkthrough of the game and backed up the game's website, the link is in the description, I managed to get access to the entirely Flash-based site. Ironically, there's no way that this would have ran on phone browsers back then, and fittingly, I could only get it working with Internet Explorer. enter whatever code the game's terminal tells you to enter into the website, and you'll usually be given a JPEG zoomed out map of the level you're currently in, which is pretty cool. It's easy to see how many nooks and crannies the maps have with an overview like this. Other times you'll get access to an in-universe news report referring to events in the game, which I kind of love. Like, there's one point where your character is publicly framed for a crime, so the police come after him, and you can hop online and read the in-universe news report which frames him. There's something novel about that. You get the sense that the developers cared about fleshing out this world. There's also one door and one elevator which can only be unlocked by visiting the website and finding some secret links, which is charmingly old internet. Obviously, it's kind of frustrating and bad that you have to visit a website that doesn't even exist anymore to unlock certain weapons or implants, but it's so of its time and it adds to the curiosity of something like this. And I like that the website goes a step further and helps introduce the cyberpunk world and run down our protagonist, Sam Gibson, a soldier indebted to the Arasaka Corporation. Mostly told through brief snippets of dialogue between Gibson and his Netrunner partner, Ka, the lightweight story, set in Cyberpunk's Night City in 2022, twists and turns enough to show how everyone is an inconsequential pawn to the all-powerful corporations, and having now read a lot of the old Cyberpunk RPG stuff for this video, it fits perfectly fine within the universe, thematically, and just consistently with the lore. I love how it ends with Gibson and Ka basically being like, "I'm sick of all this, let's go live in South America." And the cycle continues. I assume the developers were actually planning to continue the story in South America because the end screen says Cyberpunk will return to your cell phone in 2007, so within the same year this was released. It's a shame that that didn't pan out. Unfortunately, getting to that ending is pretty rough. Towards the end, a couple of ninja-looking enemies are introduced that are just incredibly frustrating to fight. They have ridiculous invincibility frames and attack you quicker than you can react, and every time you die, you have to restart the level, and you can lose over 10 minutes. There are points where I just got hopelessly juggled to death, and points where I had to cross my fingers and hope that RNGesus was on my side, and it really sours what's otherwise a surprisingly fun little adventure. I started skipping side areas and stopped hacking terminals when I had to replay the level over and over, and I swear that final level will be etched into my mind for the rest of time with how many attempts that I had at it. At least you have infinite ammo for every weapon, I guess. On the other hand, another late-game enemy that's introduced is these Terminator-like cyborgs, which are intentionally near unkillable, and it's exciting seeing one and then trying to jet past them to get to an elevator or lock a door behind you. Because the game is so difficult, there are moments like these where it's really thrilling as you escape at the last second, just a single hit away from death. Now keep in mind, I am judging this as a J2ME game, which maybe sounds condescending, but as cool as this is, and as impressed by this as I am, there's really not a lot of reason to go back to it outside of just its novelty, especially because it gets so frustrating. But I enjoyed delving into Cyberpunk's lore for this and then seeing it translate so vividly into this 2-hour-long old mobile game, and on balance, the Arasaka's plot is a formidable effort that deserves recognition for its achievements. At the time, it would have been a really fun throwback to flashback on the go, or a flashback to flashback if you will, and in hindsight it stands comfortably as one of the best side-scrolling platformers on the platform. And with that, we wrap up the video. If you want to see more Java phone game videos like this, I did one on Far Cry 2, I did one on Kane and Lynch and Hitman and God of War and The Witcher, which is kind of fitting really. So if you want to check those out, I'll leave links in the description and in the pinned comment. Normally I use this sort of moment to thank all my patrons by name, but I'm just going to list them this time as I usually do for shorter videos like this, but I still am very thankful for them. If you want to check out my Patreon to support this, there's some behind the scenes stuff and I rewatch some of my old videos and I do Q&As and that sort of thing on there, so that's worth checking out. But if you want to support in another way, you can just click like and subscribe and comment and click the bell and all that YouTuber stuff. There's a reason everyone asks you to do that. It sort of helps out with the search engines and the algorithms and making these videos get suggested. It helps me out. So if you want to support, those are some ways you can. And thank you to all the patrons that have been coming up on the screen again. And thank you for watching, and I'll see you all in the next video. Take it easy.